Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Optimizing Growth: Predictive and Profitable Strategies to Understand Demand and Outsmart Your Competitors by Jason Green, Mark Henneman, and Dimitar Antov. Narrated by Peter Berkrot. Publisher's Note: This audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material. Preface. This is a book about successfully driving profitable growth in a rapidly changing environment. Our goal is to provide principles, approaches, frameworks, and tools that can be applied to virtually any type of business in any industry, whether business to consumer, B2C, or business to business, B2B, large or small, or local or global, to help drive growth. By describing the key steps in an overarching growth process in enough detail, we hope to make each step and its related components actionable for any manager. We have attempted to provide a range of approaches from simple back-of-the-envelope exercises and key questions to sophisticated big data analytics to help kickstart any growth effort within any organization. Throughout the book, we use case examples to help bring key concepts alive. Our intent is to provide a range of case examples across industries and situations, from market-leading companies that wanted to extend their lead to turnaround situations where there was a danger of failing. We hope the cases will be both informative and inspiring. When growth has stalled, it is often a symptom of fundamental changes among customers and markets that may make the tried-and-true playbook that drove prior successes less effective. Beyond having a plan for reigniting growth, it takes personal courage and conviction to undertake a process that might challenge the organization's conventional wisdom, and then alter or even rewrite the playbook that built the business in the first place. The book will reinforce four key themes based on our experiences that we believe are critical for successfully achieving growth objectives. First, we believe that the most certain path for achieving profitable growth begins with insights into demand. We think of demand as the solutions consumers and customers are seeking across the entire range of situations they experience day in and day out. A solution for feeling more energized in the morning. A solution for transforming my business from selling products to providing services. A solution for paying off credit card debt, and so on. Some groups or segments of consumers, customers, are highly satisfied with the current solutions available to them. Others are highly dissatisfied with everything they are aware of or have tried. This is why sales figures are not a true indicator of the actual demand in a given market. Sales receipts do not measure unfulfilled demand. Understanding how demand varies by segment of consumer and customer is a critical aspect of identifying the most attractive growth opportunities in the market. Demand is not one homogeneous block. Developing insights into what we call demand segments, along with insights into what drives demand, what fulfills demand, and the economics of demand, make up the foundation for building a successful growth strategy. In addition, we believe much greater precision will be needed to drive growth than ever before. More precise insights leading to more precise investments and actions will reduce waste and create a potentially significant edge. Understanding precisely who to win with and how to win with them will require increasing levels of precision as retail channels expand, media options fragment, and the choices available to consumers and customers increase dramatically. For example, if businesses don't have a precise understanding of the new digital path to purchase, the most critical search terms being used by attractive customers, or the role of ratings and rankings on purchase decisions, their offers may never even make the consideration set for key consumers. We also believe that growth is best achieved through a comprehensive system that continually identifies and tests potential growth hypotheses. The system we propose is focused on continually answering what we call the how, who, what, where, why, and how to of growth opportunities. Starting from demand, we believe managers have to constantly ask and update their learnings about how demand is shifting and what the drivers of those changes are. The next question to address is to determine who the most attractive segments of consumers and customers are, based on their demand within a given category. Then the firm can go deep with those attractive consumers and customers to understand precisely what their demand is for and how to fulfill it. Our goal is to describe a step-by-step system to follow that can be regularly updated to enhance the level of insights into demand. Finally, almost every aspect of the growth process can be improved by leveraging big data capabilities, including digital approaches. Whatever your starting point, we believe the ability to leverage big data, including digital approaches, in ways that create a more precise understanding of demand, customers, competitors, and opportunities, will become an increasingly important driver of competitive advantage. To be clear, big data in and of itself is not a strategy or a panacea for curing growth issues, nor will sustainable growth be achieved by taking a flawed business model, a set of offers that are not aligned to demand, and a weak brand online. The promise of big data is to help identify trends and enhance your understanding of opportunities, not to do the critical thinking for you. Ultimately, it is our hope that this book will inspire you to drive growth within your organization while providing the tools you will need to achieve your growth objectives. Section 1. Why Greater Precision? Chapter 1. The Growth Challenge. The Big Ideas. Profitable organic revenue growth is harder than ever to achieve due to economic conditions, demographic shifts, changing consumer demand, and disruptive technologies, among other drivers. Despite this dynamic, profitable organic growth remains critical to the success of every business. Many of the traditional approaches for driving growth are not as successful as they once were. A new, more precise business model, built on actionable insights into consumer demand and powered by emerging big data capabilities, is a proven approach to achieving profitable growth. Net-net, economic growth slowing plus margins for error declining equals easy growth behind us. Mary Meeker, Kleiner Perkins Caulfield Buyer. Few quotes sum up the current challenges facing businesses around the world better than this insight from Mary Meeker's annual Internet Trends Report from 2016. Perhaps growth was never easy to achieve, but clearly it will only get harder going forward. All of which makes the ability to successfully achieve profitable organic revenue growth an even greater competitive advantage going forward. But how do managers get from the realities Mary Meeker points out to the systematic growth they need? Answering that question in detail is the purpose of this book: to share the approaches, frameworks, and analyses needed to identify and realize growth opportunities with greater precision, regardless of function or industry, and to do so with solutions that range from simple back-of-the-envelope exercises to those that use sophisticated big data analytics. Precision that pays. Ultimately, achieving profitable growth in a rapidly changing environment requires a more precise business system, complete with actionable insights into customer demand that leverage big data capabilities as much as possible. Building a more precise, demand-based business system has helped our clients, across industries and around the world, to attain new levels of growth after years of flat or declining sales, despite challenging market conditions, a changing competitive set, and disruptive new technologies. In our experience, precision that pays starts with new insights into a firm's most valuable customers. Not just who they are and what they buy, but how they think about a category, a firm's offers, the brand, and the competition. Those insights are translated into more precise ways of reaching high-value customers and consumers in their preferred purchase locations, and in the forms of media with which they are most engaged, through a more compelling message, and ultimately with offers that are more closely tailored to their demands. In short, the model we are describing starts by anticipating the demands of your most attractive customers, aligning offers and all business functions to serve those demands, and continually improving every aspect of the business by using a test-and-learn approach to monitor results and adapt as needed. This structure depends upon big data, or the growing sets of data that are now available, and analytics, by which we mean the tools for analyzing and making sense of those data. The dynamic growth in available information about consumers, in addition to increased sophistication in the tools and techniques used in synthesizing those data, are essential components in this framework. An overview of the approach and the questions addressed at each step could appear as shown in figures 1.1 and 1.2 in the bonus PDF. Precision, in the context of this discussion, has two distinct meanings. One important aspect of precision is assessing how accurately you understand customer demand for your products. A good gauge for determining if you have the insights you need to build from is to ask yourself and your team a question that the founder of our firm, Rick Cash, often asks our clients. What do you know about the demand of your most profitable customers that your competitors don't know? Many business leaders take pause at this deceptively simple question, in part because they are not exactly certain who their most profitable customers are or how best to describe them. Beyond that, they may have only a rudimentary knowledge of their customers' most important needs and the rational, emotional, and social reasons that really drive their purchase decisions. The ultimate litmus test is to identify those insights that are truly proprietary to your business. These are the insights that create potentially significant advantages because they are not known to your competitors. Or at the very least, your competitors are not acting on them. It is the type of insight we uncovered in our work with Allstate Insurance that led Allstate to be the first to offer accident forgiveness and deductible rewards for good drivers. Prior to introducing the accident forgiveness and the deductible rewards features in a new offer Allstate called Your Choice Auto Insurance, Allstate and other insurance companies that sold through insurance agencies were facing significant pressure from insurance companies like Geico that sold policies directly over the phone or online. The direct model had much lower costs than the agent model, which allowed the direct players to charge less for no-frills insurance packages. Geico, the leader among direct players, embodied this approach through its well-known ad slogan, 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. As the no-frills direct insurance players continued to grow, the management team at Allstate was concerned that car insurance was quickly becoming a commodity market in which the lowest-cost provider would always win. Increasingly, the benefits of having a personal insurance agent located close by did not seem to justify the costs of the agent-based model. The team at Allstate wondered how it could break out of the commodity trap by successfully differentiating its offers while also making its agent network an advantage again. The answer would come from two important proprietary customer insights. First, Allstate discovered through quantitative research that lowest price was not the only consideration among all car insurance customers. In fact, about 40% of consumers were looking for high-quality coverage and the ability to protect their net worth in the event of a car accident. Second, Allstate came to realize how unfair these highly attractive, quality-focused insurance customers thought car insurance was. These customers did not understand why even the most responsible driver could be penalized for things that they could not possibly control, such as having his or her car damaged by another driver while parked in a parking lot. It also seemed incredibly unfair that consumers paid insurance premiums for coverage year after year. But if the consumer ever actually needed to use his or her insurance policy by filing a claim for an at-fault accident, those premiums would suddenly spike upward. What these valuable consumers really wanted was to make the current relationship with their insurer less one-sided and much more reciprocal. With these insights, Allstate created Your Choice Auto Insurance to satisfy those complaints of inequity that the company was hearing from its most valuable customers. Allstate's accident forgiveness feature was perfectly designed to appeal to the most responsible drivers in the market. This feature allowed an Allstate customer a limited number of at-fault accidents over time that could be forgiven, meaning the accident would not raise the driver's insurance premiums the way most other auto insurance policies would. The accident forgiveness offer was incredibly appealing to good drivers, for they were willing to pay a slight premium for protection against the risk of unexpected rate increases. Moreover, drivers who had frequent accidents over a relatively short period would quickly see their monthly premiums rise and would never realize the type of benefit their low-risk counterparts gained from accident forgiveness. Additionally, low-risk drivers were less likely to leave Allstate because they were earning deductible rewards or period-over-period rate decreases as a reward for a clean driving record each year they went without an accident. Allstate's Your Choice Auto Insurance became the most successful new auto insurance offer the company had ever introduced at that point. Soon after the new offers were introduced, the Wall Street Journal reported that Your Choice was having a significant impact on sales. Anita Sally, an Allstate agent in Bartlett, Tennessee, says her sales of Your Choice products are up 20 to 30% over sales of Allstate standard product. Ultimately, Your Choice was so successful in the car insurance market that the concept was also extended to home insurance. Beyond the precision behind proprietary insights like those that Allstate leveraged, we also use precision in the context of making the best resource allocation decisions in order to win in the market. Actionable demand insights have helped our clients optimize decisions about where to invest to generate attractive returns and where to avoid spending. Allstate saw this firsthand with the decision to target customers who were seeking higher quality rather than the lowest price, which facilitated the decision to design and launch successful Your Choice Auto Insurance offers to win with those customers rather than wasting resources chasing cost-conscious customers. In many cases, these precise new insights are either identified through or enabled by the use of big data. This data-driven precision has generated actionable insights that have spurred countless clients to invest in exactly those products or services that are most valued by their key customers, while avoiding the wasted spending from adding costly features that those same customers do not value. In addition, for products sold through retail stores, more precise insights into demand allow businesses to determine which stores have the highest potential for selling their products and which stores should be avoided. One approach for identifying the highest potential retail stores for a given product is to map all 117 million U.S. households to the stores where they shop, using Nielsen data or other proprietary data sets. The level of precision possible can even determine exactly where within a specific store a given product should be sold and how it should be merchandised. A more refined understanding of demand can also be the catalyst for the development of an entirely new business model, instead of simply adapting old models to fit new targets. The guiding principle is to focus on what we call precision that pays, or proprietary customer insights that explain the drivers of customer preference and why they really choose the products and services they buy. The right level of precision helps guide the best possible resource allocation decisions while avoiding unnecessary waste. Ultimately, precision that pays can increase sales while lowering costs, as the case studies in this book will demonstrate. A challenging growth environment. We believe greater precision will be needed as the rapid, often dramatic changes taking place in today's business environment make the challenge of achieving profitable growth going forward more difficult than ever. Among the major drivers of these significant shifts are a slowing economy, globalization, demographic changes, digital disruption to traditional business models, other new technologies such as 3D printing, nanotechnology and robotics, evolving consumer trends, and changing competitive dynamics. Any one of these factors alone might pose challenges to an individual firm's growth prospects, but taken together, they create major barriers. As Mary Meeker points out, in a business environment with margins for error declining, success will require greater precision than ever before. One of the most significant impediments to corporate growth is the stagnant economic environment that the United States and many other countries are experiencing. Unfortunately, the U.S. economic forecast continues to have bleak short-term prospects, with low growth coupled with increasing uncertainty. The Conference Board projected U.S. GDP growth of 2.2% in 2018, which is far below the historical average from 1948 to 2010 of 3.31%. Long-term projections forecast lower levels of GDP growth as a new normal for the U.S. According to the PricewaterhouseCoopers PwC report, the world in 2050, published in 2015, average real GDP growth for the U.S. from 2014 to 2050 is projected to be only 2.4% annually. In many parts of the developed world, prospects for economic growth are even lower than the U.S. forecast. The same PwC report projects average real GDP growth per year for the European Union at 2.0% for the period from 2014 to 2050. Notably, key developed markets, including Germany and Japan, are expected to experience GDP growth rates of only 1.5% and 1.4% respectively. GDP growth rates for both Germany and Japan will be pulled down in part by negative population growth rates of 0.4% and 0.5% respectively, according to the PwC report. Meanwhile, the rapid growth experienced by many developing markets, especially China, has cooled over the past decade. Over the past 20 years, 1996 to 2015, real global GDP growth averaged 3.8% per year, according to the International Monetary Fund's World Economic Report from April 2016. During that same period, China experienced average GDP growth of over 9.4%, based on data from the World Bank. As recently as 2007, China had achieved annual real GDP growth of over 14%. However, even China is forecast to regress closer to the global mean, with projected annual GDP growth of only 3.4%. for 2014 to 2050, according to PwC. Meanwhile, global GDP growth for 2014 to 2050 is forecast to decline by almost 25% to about 3.0% annual growth. Generational shifts in the U.S. One of the drivers of the low growth forecast for the U.S. is a major demographic shift. Consumer spending currently accounts for over two-thirds of the U.S. economy, which is an outcome of the economic growth seen in the U.S. post-World War II, along with the rapid population growth during that period that became commonly known as the baby boom. Throughout the baby boom, generally considered the period from 1946 to 1964, the U.S. population increased by an average of about 1.8% per year. In contrast, the U.S. population grew by only 0.7% from July 2015 to July of 2016, according to the U.S. Census. The last time that U.S. population growth rates this low were recorded was in 1937, as the U.S. suffered through the Great Depression. Starting in 2015, baby boomers were no longer the largest living age group in the U.S. Instead, the millennial generation, which is considered by the U.S. Census to have been born between 1982 and 2000, surpassed the boomers in terms of number of people. Looking forward to 2020, the U.S. Census Bureau predicts that there will be 81 million millennials and about 71 million boomers. As millennials grow as a percentage of the total U.S. population, they will also grow in terms of purchasing power. Household spending attributed to millennials is projected to eclipse the spending represented by boomer households starting in 2018 or 2019. By 2020, millennial households in the U.S. will spend over $1.8 trillion annually, while boomer households are expected to spend under $1.6 trillion per year. All of this evidence shows that, after this inflection point, the U.S. will transition from a boomer-driven economy to one driven by millennial spending. Several interrelated economic and demographic factors will weigh on the U.S. economy during this transition. First, the U.S. middle class continues to shrink. From 1971 to 2015, adults in the U.S. middle class, defined as households with an annual income between $41,000 and $125,000, has dropped from 61% of adults to 50% of adults. At the same time, the two lowest U.S. income brackets have increased by 4 percentage points, from 25% to 29%, and the two highest U.S. income tiers have grown by 7 percentage points, from 14% to 21%. Given these trends, along with the fact that consumer spending represents about 2/3 of U.S. GDP, a vibrant, growing middle class and the millions of purchases that these consumers make every day are absolutely critical to driving GDP growth. Millennials are just entering what should be their peak earning and spending years. In the U.S., income and spending both tend to increase until age 34, before peaking from ages 35 to 54. Starting at age 55, income and spending begin to decline. The oldest millennials are just turning 35, but the spending and economic growth this generation should be driving may be delayed, as millennials delay the many major life milestones, including marriage, starting a family, or buying a home, that often trigger significant spending. One of the reasons millennials may be delaying key life stages and the spending they typically trigger is the crushing amount of student debt they have accrued. In the span of just a few years, from 2005 to 2012, the average amount of student debt among Americans under 30 almost doubled, from $13,340 to $24,897. By 2016, the average graduate had over $37,000 in student loans, and as a generation, millennials are carrying the majority of the staggering $1.4 trillion in U.S. student loan debt. No wonder the wedding has to wait. Marriage among millennials does provide a case in point for how dramatic these generational changes have been. In the 1970s, 80% of Americans aged 30 or younger were married. Today, 80% of Americans aged 45 or younger are married, because most millennials have significantly delayed marriage versus prior generations. In fact, it is more common for millennials aged 18 to 34 to live with their parents than to live with a spouse. Compare this to 1975, when the majority of 18 to 34-year-olds, fully 57% of them, lived with their spouse. The fact that millennials have delayed leaving home and starting households of their own has slowed housing starts and dampened the housing sector, which is a major part of the U.S. economy as a whole. As officials from the Federal Reserve Bank of San Francisco reported, the recovery in the housing sector has been even slower than for the overall economy. In particular, the pace of housing starts remains subdued by historical standards. This muted recovery can be traced in part to the slow pace of household formation, especially among young adults. In turn, the share of young adults living with parents has grown in recent years. Whether or not millennials will spend at the level of prior generations as they hit the traditional peak earning and spending years is an open question. What is not being questioned is the fact that boomers, who are retiring in record numbers, will begin spending less. By 2060, the number of Americans aged 65 and older is expected to more than double, from about 46 million people today to over 98 million in 2060. According to Derek Thompson of The Atlantic, of the many significant forces shaping the U.S. economy, including globalization, automation, and housing supply, none is so inevitable and invisible as the sheer march of time for today's adults. In the 1950s, at the height of the U.S. manufacturing supremacy, less than 10% of the country was older than 65. That share will double to 20% by 2050. The Age of Disruption. In addition to an increasingly difficult growth environment, many established companies and industries are facing new types of competitors, often from non-traditional players, as industry disruption becomes the norm. Online models and technology have been broadly leveraged to disrupt major industries, including retailing, media, financial services, and automotive, among others. In the retail industry, Amazon and other online retailers are changing the face of the nearly $5 trillion U.S. retail industry. Long gone are the days of the general store and its motto, "If we don't have it, you don't need it." The virtually unlimited selection, incredible convenience, and increasingly rapid product delivery of online shopping has put pressure on traditional brick-and-mortar stores of all types, including department stores, specialty retailers, and increasingly grocery stores. Amazon's acquisition of Whole Foods in June of 2017 certainly seems to underscore how serious online retailers are about growing in grocery. Online retail sales have more than doubled from 2010 to 2016, going from $153 billion to $387 billion, or from about 4% of total sales to 8% of total retail sales. More importantly, the percent of consumers who researched their purchase online but then bought it in a physical store has jumped from 24% in 2010 to 58% in 2016. While retail sales as a whole increased at a rate of about 3.4% per year from 2010 to 2016, the portion of sales that was either digitally influenced or completed online grew by 17% per year. At the same time, traditional store-based retail sales with no online research or any type of online involvement declined by over $1 trillion from 2010 to 2016. Meanwhile, looking beyond retail, Facebook, Google, and Netflix, along with other social media sites, search engines, and streaming media services, are changing the ways people consume media, find information, and spend their free time, all of which has had an enormous impact on traditional media, including television, radio, and newspapers. As audiences have increasingly moved online, the advertisers have followed, by using their ad budgets to target digital consumers with greater frequency. In 2016, advertising spent in the U.S. topped $200 billion, making the U.S. by far the largest advertising market in the world in terms of dollars. 2016 represented an inflection point in the advertising world, as for the first time, digital ad spending eclipsed TV ad spend. This shift marked a dramatic change for an industry that was dominated by the big three TV networks, ABC, CBS, and NBC, from the late 1940s to the early 1990s. During that period, almost any advertiser could reach the audience it wanted to influence on one of the three major TV networks. Now, TV audiences are much more fragmented across hundreds of channels, while the two biggest digital players, Google and Facebook, provide access to huge audiences and offer the ability to target customers more precisely than ever before. The shift from TV to digital will continue to swing, as digital ad spend is projected to grow to over $105 billion by 2020, while TV ad spend will increase more modestly to about $77 billion. Clearly, in this new age of disruption, the real question is not who or when your business will be disrupted, But how can you best disrupt your own industry? Technology is not the only driver of disruption, however. Changes in consumer preferences are bringing significant disruption to many industries, including the U.S. food and beverage industry. Industry veteran Steve Hughes, who had leadership roles at Conagra, Tropicana, Celestial Seasonings, and White Wave before founding Boulder Brands, told Fortune magazine, "I've been doing this for 37 years, and this is the most dynamic, disruptive, and transformational time that I've seen in my career." A similarly stark picture for the packaged food industry is painted by Bob Wheatley, who is the CEO of Emergent. Wheatley, whose firm helps companies understand the potential business opportunities as consumers pursue healthier living, noted in a blog post, "The single most important and disruptive change in food culture, now winding its way through virtually every part of the industry, is the overwhelming desire for fresh foods. The packaged food world finds itself facing a state of transition as fresh versions overtake and replace their processed cousins. We are moving from a production-fueled system to a demand-driven system, founded on the consumer's interest in real foods." In an interesting reversal taking place across industries, the traditional barriers to entry that have long protected established industries and businesses have increasingly become impediments to their success. Economies of scale and vertical integration across the supply chain once allowed large firms with familiar mass-marketed brands to consolidate industries by buying up smaller rivals or making it nearly impossible for them to compete successfully. Now, many fast-growing businesses across industries, including food, beverage, clothing, and fashion accessories, are the small, authentic brands that charge a premium price for products that are handcrafted, artisanal, small batch, or bespoke. These brands do not have huge economies of scale, massive advertising and promotion budgets, or dominant distribution networks. As Denise Morrison, CEO of the Campbell Soup Company, noted, "We understand that increasing numbers of consumers are seeking authentic, genuine food experiences, and we know that they are very skeptical of the ability of large, long-established food companies to deliver them." Meanwhile, the sharing economy has created platforms for ride-sharing, Uber and Lyft, peer-to-peer lending, GoFundMe, home rental, Airbnb, and even sharing power tools and other equipment with neighbors, peer-buy. In many respects, the sharing economy really demonstrates a fundamental shift from the traditional definition of businesses as one of two types: businesses that sell to other businesses, B2B, or businesses that sell to consumers, B2C. The sharing economy is typically made up of platforms that allow consumer-to-consumer, C2C, transactions to provide goods and services. These C2C transactions generally focus on monetizing the many underutilized items consumers own, from renting out infrequently used items such as power saws, prom dresses, or weekend homes, to using extra cash to provide loans to others. These sharing economy platforms allow people to use sporadic periods of free time to engage in a side hustle to earn extra money. One of the major reasons that the sharing economy is a relatively recent phenomenon is that virtually all sharing economy businesses rely on big data, complex analytics, and emerging technologies and platforms to make them possible. The profitable growth imperative. Despite the potential headwinds, profitable growth is still the key to a successful business. As a McKinsey quarterly article from 2015 noted, there's no escaping the fact that growth is a critical driver of performance as measured by total returns to shareholders, TRS, and TRS underperformers are far more likely to be acquired. The most successful businesses reliably generate meaningful levels of growth for shareholders and remain independent, while those publicly traded firms that fail to drive consistent growth are more likely to be taken over by new owners. Simply put, growth separates the winners from the also-rans. When evaluating firms to invest in or acquire, Warren Buffett, arguably the world's most successful investor, uses consistent profitable growth as his preliminary search criterion. One measure of profitable growth is return on shareholders' equity, ROE, which is a robust metric for assessing the underlying health of a business, while also providing a benchmark versus other companies. In addition, ROE, which is calculated as a firm's net income divided by its shareholders' equity, can be a useful indicator of a firm's future potential. As noted by the aforementioned equation, ROE will grow as net income increases, assuming constant shareholders' equity. However, simply having a brief spike in ROE, driven by cost-cutting or a one-off new product, is not enough to demonstrate the strong trend for which Buffett is searching. Instead, he and his team at Berkshire Hathaway focus on acquiring publicly traded companies with long histories of independently audited results that can be analyzed to determine the drivers of net income growth, along with the sustainability of those drivers. Warren Buffett looks for other key metrics in addition to ROE, such as the uniqueness of the company's product offerings, the firm's profit margins, the firm's debt levels, and the strength of the management team, among others. As a value investor, Buffett also looks to purchase businesses with attractive growth prospects at a discount to what he believes to be the intrinsic value of the company. However, the business's potential to drive profitable growth going forward is the real key. In an interview with the Financial Crisis Inquiry Commission in 2010, Buffett summed this up as pricing power, noting, "The single most important decision in evaluating a business is pricing power. If you've got the power to raise prices without losing business to a competitor, you've got a very good business. And if you have to have a prayer session before raising prices by 10%, then you've got a terrible business." Raising prices without losing share to a competitor is one driver of profitable growth and is a reflection of a highly differentiated set of products or services without meaningful substitutes. The innovation edge. Some businesses, like Apple, drive organic growth and pricing power through successful innovation. As Walter Isaacson noted in his best-selling biography, Steve Jobs, "At a time when the United States is seeking ways to sustain its innovative edge, and when societies around the world are trying to build creative digital age economies, Jobs stands as the ultimate icon of inventiveness, imagination, and sustained innovation. He and his colleagues at Apple were able to think differently. They developed not merely modest product advances based on focus groups, but whole new devices and services that consumers did not yet know they needed." So why not use innovation as a means of driving growth by introducing exciting new must-have products to customers, as Steve Jobs did? The problem, of course, is that Steve Jobs was the exception rather than the rule, for achieving successful innovation is incredibly difficult to execute and sustain. In fact, a recent study published in the Harvard Business Review reported that 84% of corporate leaders say innovation is a high priority, and that 94% are dissatisfied with their firm's innovation performance. Without Steve Jobs, even Apple appears to have lost some of its innovation edge. Adam Leshinsky, author of Inside Apple, had this to say 1 year after Steve Jobs' death. "Apple just had one of the most extraordinary 15-year runs in business history. It is unreasonable to duplicate that, even if Jobs were still alive." And a National Public Radio report from 2017 argues, "Both Apple fans and analysts who follow the company are beginning to wonder whether Apple has lost its mojo." Even Apple co-founder Steve Wozniak told Bloomberg Canada in a 2017 interview that his bet is that the next great innovation, or moonshot as he called it, will not come from Apple, but from Tesla. None of this is to say that innovation is impossible, or that innovation should not be explored as a means of driving growth. It simply points out the reality that meaningful innovation, like profitable growth overall, has become more difficult for most businesses to achieve. The good news, as we will discuss later, is that a more precise understanding of demand, customers, competitors, and market opportunities has helped our clients across industries to identify and introduce many of the most successful new offers they have ever launched. Big data's role. Could big data be the answer for finding profitable growth? Big data has become a common buzzword that many business managers use today without a very deep understanding of what it means or how it could be used to support their growth initiatives. As Floyd Yeager, SVB at Allstate, put it, "Everyone is saying big data is going to change the world, but companies have to figure out what's important to them and get out of the hyped world." In other words, most businesses need to stop talking about big data and must go beyond merely collecting massive amounts of information. They need to start leveraging those data in ways that tangibly impact business performance. We define big data as a vast ecosystem of diverse pieces of information sourced from different domains that are supported by computer science, machine learning, and data visualization technologies. The power and the promise of big data can be harnessed across all aspects of the business, especially in support of identifying and executing profitable growth. Specifically, big data can be used to help form new hypotheses, generate insights, conduct statistical testing, create simulations, and build predictive models to answer the whys, the hows, the wheres, and the whens of consumer needs and behavior, competitive dynamics, and market evolution. These approaches could yield unprecedented levels of proprietary, actionable knowledge of your customers, along with precise, strategic, and tactical plans to satisfy their demands. Despite its promise, big data alone is not the answer to profitable growth. In many cases, business practitioners make the mistake of attributing causal effects to spurious correlations found in the data. One example of this issue that many consumers experience is the seemingly endless stream of ads that pop up on every website you visit. These ads will invite customers to purchase the exact same chinos, Mother's Day gift, or coffee maker that they recently purchased online. This example is a mistaken use of what is called behavioral data. The underlying logic is that the behavior observed is strongly correlated to something this individual will do again, or is highly interested in purchasing again. In this case, the behavior of buying some chinos leads to the mistaken assumption that the person who recently bought chinos will buy more chinos today. So, as the person who bought chinos explores his or her favorite websites, social media outlets, and search engines, the algorithms keep serving up offers for chinos, even though that person may not be interested in buying chinos again, in the short or long run. When used effectively, past historical information that is backward-looking in nature actually can be very predictive of future outcomes. Winston Churchill highlighted this point when he said, "The farther back you can look, the farther forward you are likely to see." The meaningful correlation for the person buying chinos might be that he or she purchases chinos every other year, or that the chinos are purchased each spring, or even whenever the weather in his or her town gets back above 60 degrees.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.